And welcome, everybody, to the Monastery, the open bar of the internet, the world's greatest shit show, and the place where we, the good brothers and sisters of this most holy of temples, seek enlightenment through the drunkest, craziest, and most batshit ways possible. I am your one and only gaming monk, better known as Mildra, and with me I have not one but two newcomers to the temple. Paul St. John-Mackintosh and Lawrence Whitaker, who most recently kickstarted together the RPG Casting the Runes, based on the work of M.R. James, and I do want to congratulate you both on that. So,
thank you. Thank you.
How are you guys doing tonight? Or today?
Well, after that introduction, shell-shocked, I think, but otherwise very good.
Yeah, I try to open up with a bang.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a cold night here in Budapest, but I've got some wine by me, so I'll try and get by.
It's not quite gin o'clock in Canada yet, so I'm on coffee.
I'm on Killebrew because Minnesota.
Of course. Okay. Yeah, my condolences.
I have the misfortune of watching the Wild every week. So yeah.
Mm-hmm. That is U.S. microbrews are one of my great pleasure.
Fantastic.
And unfortunately, it's too early for me to break out the Stein. I'm not going to be doing that for about 7 hours.
Shame. Okay, well, I'll just have to go ahead of you guys.
We appreciate your sacrifice, man.
Yeah, so, total for the team, Paul.
So,
thank you all for the team. Several.
Well, one of the good brothers in the temple is a tea enthusiast to the point where he has a t-shirt somewhere that says "Respect the Leaf." So,
depends on the leaf.
Yeah, there might be a double meaning there.
Exactly.
If you want to read into that, I did not say that. You did.
I'm in Canada.
Home of the sacred beaver.
Look, I already made the Toronto Maple Leafs joke at least once.
Yeah, you did.
But fortunately, I can say that today/tonight will not be as disappointing as a Leafs playoff game.
Yeah, nothing is rarely as disappointing as a Leafs playoff game,
especially in Boston. Anyway, so before we start into the humble beginnings part of it, would you two mind going into what what Casting the Runes is and what you're hoping to do with this game.
Sure. Lawrence, shall I go first?
Absolutely.
Okay. Basically, it's pretty much the first time that Montague Rhodes James, who is this great English classic ghost story writer, has been put into an RPG, at least to my knowledge. I think there's been one or two very small efforts in that direction, but this was the first fully systematic effort to write a full-on ghost hunting role-playing game based on his work. And H.P. Lovecraft was one of the big fans of his, wrote him a tribute in more than one tribute. There's a lot of speculation that Lovecraft modeled a lot of his style and his construction around Montague Rhodes James. But obviously, these days, Lovecraft and the Cthulhu mythos enjoys the celebrity, and James has been a bit pushed back into the shade. And so we wanted to kind of redress that balance, bring James back a bit more into the limelight, and with that, bring back this whole tradition of, you know, occultism, ghost stories, and so on, that had been, at least in role-playing circles, kind of pushed back in favor of the, you know, Cthulhu mythos, terrors, tentacle monsters, and so on. So it's kind of trying to broaden the options and the styles that horror gameplay. and revisit some stuff that really was, you know, the heart of the tradition, that's produced some really great ghost stories, great films, but not so many great RPG scenarios and rule books. So that's basically what we just thought.
Mm-hmm. And it is being published by The Design Mechanism, which was a bit of a surprise for me, because the majority of my experience with The Design Mechanism as a company has been through RuneQuest for a time, and then Mythras, which is a story in and of itself.
Yeah, I guess it is, but in a way it shouldn't be, and I'll tell you why. We're a small company, but we know the people from Chaosium very, very well. You know, they're very good friends of mine. I know a lot of the Pelgrane press people very, very well as well. I used to work with Gareth Hanrahan at Mongoose a long time ago. I did some playtesting on the Dying Earth role-playing game, which was Pelgrane's very first RPG. I know Robin Laws. There's a long history of association. And so I've therefore played Gumshoe games. And being British, growing up in Yorkshire, having friends that lived in Lincolnshire and places like that, I grew up with M.R. James's stories. So when Paul told me that he was working on a game that was Gumshoe-based and looking to popularize James's work, it was, to me, a no-brainer. The Design Mechanism is, although Mythras is our primary system, we are a publisher. We want to extend, you know, our range, our audience, and the kinds of games that we produce. So to me, it was kind of a logical extension to bring this to fruition as a project.
Yeah, and also, Pelgrane has released the Gumshoe system as an SRD, as with the Fate system and so many others. It's basically up for grabs as a toolkit. And I simply thought that this is a particularly good fit for the kind of story that M.R. James typically does, you know, which is fundamentally investigative focused, gumshoeing, you know, clue finding. So the system and the stories seemed actually a natural fit for each other. And once I started putting them together, the thing practically wrote itself. You know, it was a no-brainer.
Yeah. If it's a good game, good subject matter, that's what we're interested in as a company. And there's absolutely no question that Casting the Runes is that. Paul's done a fantastic job with this.
Mm-hmm. Now,
good to know.
Now, as I mentioned before, it's kind of a tradition, and we kind of touched on this a minute ago, but I like to focus on the humble beginnings and kind of go into the journey into where various people are when it comes to what they're working on. So walk me through kind of your first introduction to role-playing games, and what was the moment that made you want to stick with that particular hobby long term, because it's one of those things that there's always a story behind how people got into this kind of hobby.
Okay, well, if I can lead off, then actually I don't know if I'm a bit of a heretic for that, because I took a long, long detour out of the hobby. Basically, I kicked off with I think White Bear and Red Moon, and you know, the very, very earliest pre-RPG iterations of RuneQuest and Glorantha, and the earliest beginnings of Dungeons and Dragons, and was heavily into that area for about 2 or 3 years in my adolescence, mm-hmm. you know, like 15, 16 to 18, and then got out of it again, got into writing, and basically stayed with writing for pretty much 20 or 30 years. And only recently, like recently being about, 3 years ago or so, I started to wake up again to what was going on in role-playing games, partly because I realized how much bloody marvelous work was being done in weird fiction connected to Lovecraft and the Cthulhu mythos and Robert Chambers and the Yellow King. You know, there were so many great games being written around that. There were so many fascinating and really highly intellectual, really well-researched, really highly cultured projects in this area that I thought there was no sense missing out on that anymore. So got back into it, started learning again how far games had moved in my absence, and particularly discovered that, you know, this great turn from simulationist gaming to more narrative-focused gaming, you know, with systems like Gumshoe and Fate and so on. And I realized that there have been some big and really attractive changes in the way that people thought about the games and did the games. And so it was at that point I really started looking into it again and thought, how can I do this? And then that was when the penny dropped about Gumshoe, because about casting the runes, because I'd already been reading a lot of James of that of late, writing a lot of somewhat Jamesian ghost stories. And Gumshoe came along. That seemed the right system to put it all together. Mm-hmm. And that said, I continue to write fiction voluminously. You know, most weird fiction, dark fiction, psychological horror, historical fiction, and so on. So I'm definitely not taking a back seat from that at all either. But I do think the two really fit together very well. You know, gaming and writing ought to fit together at least as well as writing and Hollywood screenwriting. And I mean, if you've got writers like Clive Barker writing computer games, they should be writing role-playing games as well. No reason not to.
I like Clive Barker. He's one of the few people who was willing to really take Ebert to task when it came to his attitude on video games.
Oh yeah,
with my favorite story of his being the time that they ended up getting into an argument so bad that Clive almost punched him.
Good man. Yep. Not afraid to stand behind his convictions, that guy. Mm-hmm.
Which is something I'm always going to respect. But Lawrence, how did you get? What was your humble beginnings?
It's all Ken St. Andre's fault. I came across Dungeons and Dragons in one of the Sunday newspaper magazines that had an article on these games that didn't have boards, didn't have endings, there were no winners and losers, played using funny dice. And being that sort of geeky kind of kid, it really rang all my bells. I was reading a lot of Michael Moorcock, Tolkien, Lieber, people like that. And I was immediately hooked on this concept of a game that wasn't Monopoly or played in a traditional kind of format. And my second exposure to it was then a magazine called The Wargamer, which had a solo scenario written by Ken St. Andre that played out over the bottom of each page of the magazine. So he played one of his solo dungeons. And I played that. You had to create a character. You played through this dungeon. And it was fucking wonderful. It was the first exposure I'd had to that kind of gaming, where you created a different persona, where you built something with the dice rolls. And there were outcomes. You had choices. So I always blame Ken St. Andre for introducing me really to the what role playing games would be. I then got the purple edition of Dungeons and Dragons, which is still on my shelf. I can see it from here. Loved that. Played a lot of that at school with friends. Then went out and bought the Dungeon Master's Guide, which was the biggest disappointment of my gaming career up until then. I thought that it was going to be a complete game, and it wasn't. That I realized I'd have to buy another two books to actually make the whole thing work. I took the Dungeon Master's Guide back to the game shop, and I exchanged it for a copy of RuneQuest instead, which was actually cheaper and boxed, and I never looked back from there. I have really never played Dungeons and Dragons in any great depth since that point, although I'm actually playing in a D&D 5th edition campaign right now. So I I got into RuneQuest. Unlike Paul, I didn't come into RuneQuest and Glorantha through White Bear Red Moon. It was all through the RuneQuest first edition role-playing game. From there, I got Stormbringer because I was an avid Michael Moorcock fan. Thought, yeah, some of these adventures are pretty good. Ooh, look, Ken St. Andre writes for them. He wrote the Stormbringer game, so I sent in some scenario ideas to Chaosium. And over a period of about 3 or 4 years, and bombarding them with more and more ideas for things, they eventually decided to give me a writing project to work on. So I ended up being a published RPG writer with Chaosium. And I kind of freelanced for Chaosium for the next 10 or so years. I did a treatment of Hawkmoon as a role-playing game for them. I wrote a couple of supplements for their Elric game. Wrote a lot of fan material, wrote a lot of fan fiction that was published in various fanzines. Got on the convention circuit. That was where I met people like Greg Stafford, Sandy Peterson, and many of the other sort of Chaosium luminaries. So I've been embedded with Chaosium's history for more or less the whole of my role-playing career. I started working for Mongoose around 2006, I think it was, when they were looking for a staff writer to really develop the RuneQuest line. They had bought the RuneQuest license, or licensed RuneQuest from Greg Stafford. And it had been in abeyance for many, many years. They needed someone that knew the game system very well, somebody that knew Glorantha reasonably well. And I applied for the job, fit the bill, and got the gig. And from there, I developed a lot of the second age RuneQuest stuff that came out, as well as working on their version of an Elric game, their version of Stormbringer, of which they also have the license from Moorcock. So it's kind of a perfect storm. Eventually. When I moved to Canada, time kind of became a bit of a crunch for me, and I sort of had to leave Mongoose, so I stepped down from that for a while. I didn't write anything for a good year, and then when I found out that the RuneQuest license was coming up for a renewal and Mongoose was stepping away from it, my friend Pete Nash and I, and Pete and I go back a long, long way, done a lot of writing together, we decided to see if Greg would take a chance on us as the new custodians of RuneQuest. And that was how the design mechanism was born. That was how RuneQuest 6th edition was born. And we've kind of gone on from there. You know, it's coming up for 9 years since we formed the company. The game has changed its name to Mithras, but we've got, you know, more than 40 different supplements under our belt for that game. And it's getting stronger and stronger each year. And you know, the latest addition to that is why we're here now, which is Casting the Runes.
Yep. Now it's definitely a bit of a surprising jump. And I mentioned this before we started, but going from a percentile based system in RuneQuest slash basic, you know, that whole thing, because, dear Lord, if we were to go over the different iterations when it came to RuneQuest, we'd be here for a week. But going from that to a very narrativist D6 at best pool based approach that Gumshoe has is quite a leap. And in that regard, one of the things I wanted to ask was, When you guys were developing Casting the Runes in the early notes, was Gumshoe something that you had decided on at the beginning, or were there attempts to use this with RuneQuest's D100?
I basically landed Lawrence with the package pretty much fully formed. And I mean, to mm-hmm. some extent, I was open to discussion on the possibility of doing a, you know, percentile dice rate based version. It's just that, like I say, Gumshoe seemed to fit the material uniquely well. It was such an easy job to cast M.R. James into that mold. The other thing is that I don't think that I don't think that every system necessarily works just as well for every type of story. I think it's pretty much always possible to tell a good role-playing story with pretty much any type of system, but there are certain types that favor certain styles of system more than others. And I mean, a percentile dice-based system that is focused on simulation of action, for instance, where some degree of emulating the physical environment is a key factor, that is probably going to work better with a different style of story, something more kinetic and action-based than casting the runes, because M.R. James is very much often contemplative, analytical. There's a different rhythm, there's a different pace, there's a different focus, and it's probably going to favor a system more disposed towards storytelling and analysis. And I could very well have a stab at putting casting the runes into a percentile based type system, but another reason was simply we wanted to emphasize the clear blue water between this and Call of Cthulhu. You know, because Call of Cthulhu has definitely cornered the market in a certain area of cosmic horror. It's very well established, and there's not too much sense trying to do stuff in it immediately in its shape. So that was one other very strong reason to go with a different approach, because we didn't want end up just reiterating Call of Cthulhu's style mechanics in a very slightly different historical period and very slightly different collection of ghosts and monsters.
Yep.
So that was primarily where the thinking came from in going for Gumshoe on this. But, you know, I can still see a lot of ways to do a really good percentile-based type horror game on but again, the territory's been pretty well covered. You know, Delta Green is a fantastic, in the recent Arc Dream Delta Green is, in my opinion, a fantastically good, narratively optimized version of that kind of BRP style system. Yep. You know, emit very smooth, very easy to operate, hits the right buttons, gets itself out of the way and lets you concentrate on the story and the drama, the action and the thrills.
And the fact that your entire party is probably screwed.
Oh yes, everybody's gonna die. You know, one of the advantages of casting the runes I'm happy to talk about is that not everybody needs to go insane.
Yeah. And
if you want the You want those kind of pleasures, mind plenty of games to cater for them.
Yeah. Now, when it comes... Now, I will make note that by the time unfortunately, by the time I found out about the Kickstarter, it had already come and gone. But one thing that I definitely noticed when I was going through the preview, and this is something that I do appreciate, is that you guys went into a lot of detail about what makes M.R. James's work very very different from the works of Cthulhu. And actually, I would actually posit an argument that as much as I enjoy Call of Cthulhu and Trail of Cthulhu and other approaches, something that the whole notion that particular style of horror is encompassing, in my opinion, it's a lot more encompassing, to the point of becoming a bit of an issue where. Where there's this assumption that if you're running, when I was getting my start, there was always this inbuilt assumption that you could only do horror in RPGs in one of two flavors, Call of Cthulhu or Ravenloft. And I especially noticed this one. I remember reading through a book that had a lot of old RPG reviews, and one of the games that was in that review list was Chill, which was described as a horror game for the easily frightened.
Mm-hmm.
Even though the approach that Chill's approach that they're trying to go with is they're not trying to do the same kind of horror that you would see in Cthulhu or Lovecraft. They are trying to go for Universal slash Hammer, pre-Kitsch Universal, I should say. I mean, when you have Elvira being on the cover of one of the modules, you're not taking yourself all that serious. I definitely believe that there needs to be that kind of variety in horror. You can't have it one size fits all. And speaking from experience moment when you mentioned cringing at people trying to cram in Lovecraft in places that it didn't belong?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know how much experience Lawrence has had of this, but certainly I found it that, for instance, it's something I reference in the introduction to this game, is you find there are so many scenarios where a story that has been taken from folklore, from legend, that obviously has really deep roots in a very different tradition, is suddenly outed at the end as some manifestation of Nyarlathotep or something. Or, you know, that's, suddenly the Kraken turns out to be all deep ones. Every maritime horror story in the history of humanity turns out to be all deep ones, etc. It's basically reducing everything to this one size fits all,
I just realized what sorry to cut you off, but I just realized what the best term for that kind of thing is. It's the Moriarty problem.
Yeah, completely. I mean, it's not to disrespect Call of Cthulhu and Lovecraftian gaming in any way, because I do them all the time. I enjoy them fantastically. And I still think there's loads of good ways to tell fresh, interesting, and scary stories with those games. It's just that certain approaches have been overdone, and it's tended to crowd other things out of the light. And part of the thing with this game is I wanted people to have a toolkit to resurrect all these incredible global myths, legends, horror stories, ancient ancestral creatures, and so on. There's so much of it. I mean, you hardly need to bother writing scenario supplements for Casting the Roots, because you open up any local history in any county in Britain or any country in Europe, and immediately you've got about 10, 20 different scenarios ready-made just jumping into your lap. You know, any book of local folklore will serve you up with this fantastic choice of unique and original monsters. And that's like such a rich vocabulary that it makes no sense to just be speaking Lovecraftian all the time, nothing else.
I remember a long time ago running, because it was the only thing I had at the time. I used the system for Call of Cthulhu, but the monster that I wanted to go with was the Wendigo. Because given the region that I come from, you've got a lot of forest, and you've got a lot of those kind of stories. I think it's also the reason why I ended up enjoying German opera so much. Just because there's a lot of things in the forest and a lot of things that are more than willing to try and kill you. I remember someone asking what if it was if it if it was some incarnation of Yogg-Sothoth, and I'm like, no, it's a Wendigo.
Mm.
That full stop.
Mm.
And
yep.
in the vein of that, I saw that you guys decided to not utilize the sanity system because I think you want people to be unnerved. Am I right on this? You want people to be unnerved, but not necessarily in the we're all doomed and you're going slowly mad from the revelation kind of thing.
Yep. Mm-hmm. And I mean, again, especially back in the day when it was first introduced, back in the earliest generations of Call of Cthulhu, that was and is a fantastic fun mechanic for a certain type of gameplay, you know, and it can have great fun with it. But I mean, leaving aside the questions of sensitivity about genuine mental illness, it does drive you towards one style of play and one kind of attitude to your whole game and your whole story. And Gumshoe has a very solid stability mechanic, which does allow for a lot of psychological trauma, a lot of psychological impact and gaming around that, but it doesn't have the same focus on actually going mad. So that seemed to be far better balance for this, not least because M.R. James's protagonists don't go mad, by and large. They get scared, but they don't go gaga. And just as a different example of something that I think also really brought something new and interesting to the table, recent Fate of Cthulhu, which is a fate-based game that's just about to come out from Evil Hat. I think it's, you know, it's just gone through final stages of its Kickstarter. They've also ditched insanity. In their case, it's in favor of something called corruption, where the Cthulhu mythos, instead of challenging your grasp on reality, it actually physically distorts your reality. So you corrupt and mutate under the influence of the mythos, which is actually quite close to a lot of Michael Moorcock stuff. You know, back in the day where with Elric, that was chaos gods were busily causing mutations in people. So it goes back a lot in the history of gaming as well. And I think that works really well, too, in a different way. So very, very happy to ring the changes on the insanity mechanic and do something a bit different.
Yeah, M.R. James's stories are very different to the works of Lovecraft as well. There's a very distinct tradition in Britain around the nature that the ghost story takes. And M.R. James is responsible for really creating that whole paradigm. And what Casting the Runes does is emulate very, very, very well the feeling of a Jamesian story, which is what we want. So the mechanics enable the kind of atmosphere that the game needs to portray. We're not aiming to do Lovecraftian psychological horror. We're not aiming to do Vampire the Masquerade kind of Grand Guignol horror. This is very much an English ghost story recreation. And Paul was right in saying that the folklore of Britain and Europe is absolutely steeped in these kind of atmospherics. And that's really what the game captures. So the game mechanics need to be able to support that. And as Paul says, the characters in M.R. James's stories, who tend to be academics, they tend to be antiquarians. They tend to be they're not the private investigators of Call of Cthulhu or the tomb raiders of that kind of thing. They're very much academics, dons, professors who are steeped in their own area of expertise that stumble across something that is really unnerving, really uncanny. They don't go mad. They do get scared. They get unnerved. Yeah, they find they can't explain something.
They get in other ways.
Mm-hmm. Yes. That they encounter something that's beyond their understanding of the world. And that in itself, I think, is disturbing enough quite often. So that's what Cast in the Runes really gets to the heart of. We don't need the sanity mechanics for that. The stability system that's in there does that supremely well. And I think also the approach that you need to take is very different to a typical kind of Call of Cthulhu scenario. It's something that's going to, that builds and unnerves rather than hits you with shocks all the time.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, 2 points on this. One is that James was always emphasizing in his stories and his criticism that if you want to scare people, you really scare them, you've got to pace it. You know, you've got to hold back those revelations and drop them in one by one to beget that build-up that really makes the thing, what the final thing, that much more shocking when it does arrive. And, you know, but with some Lovecraftian stories, at least by the end, Lovecraft has gone so over the top into like rhetoric, you know, overheated descriptions that it just goes beyond horrible into maybe just a little bit ludicrous. Mm. And James never does that. Another thing with James and the period that he's writing, James does this a bit, but a lot of his contemporaries do it more. Is that he is writing in the period of the occult, the first flowering of the occult detective story. You know, because a lot of his contemporaries are writing in the immediate aftermath of Sherlock Holmes and Conan Doyle. So mm-hmm. they developed this genre of the occult detective, which is the Carnacki-style character, the sort of earlier version of the Dresden Files or of Anita Blake. You've got a sort of quintessentially golden age of detection, occult detective who is just doing detective stories that happen to deal with the occult and the supernatural. So that almost becomes a very flowering subgenre in itself as well. And that's something that hasn't really been captured by Call of Cthulhu either, although to some extent Cthulhu by Gaslight does it. But there's a real, you know, pretty much uncharted territory with the writings of William Hope Hodgson, Arthur Machen, Algernon Blackwood, and a slew of other really good horror writers at around the same time of James as well, who we've also managed to put into the book.
Yep. I remember someone once talking about when mentioning horror is that when you're watching a horror film, one of the main focuses should be on putting characters and people in a place that all logic should dictate they shouldn't be in, and mm-hmm. where a game, whether it be a video game or tabletop, can twist that knife is you're willingly going into this place that all logic says you should stay the hell away from.
Yep.
And it's in the same vein that, and I'm pretty sure every horror writer says this with like it's a mantra or something, but 90% mm-hmm. of horror is atmosphere.
Yeah.
And in that vein, Is it fair of me to assume that there's a lot that you'll be going into detail about how to create that atmosphere for the GM for his players?
Yeah, well, certainly doing the best. I mean, honestly, there is no better primer than the stories themselves. James is an absolute master at how to create a spooky, you know, spooky horrific atmosphere. You know, obviously, we've done our best with this book to do that. There are many other great primers out there on how to build horror in gaming. And I do recommend that people go out and seek that advice as well and find out what works best for their team of players.
Mm-hmm. Now, when it comes to... Obviously, let me get the elephant out of the room. I am a filthy, dirty, unwashed American. it is unfortunate, but that is my cross to bear. So because of that, I'm fairly certain that there's going to be plenty of people in my own particular camp on this front who are not as familiar with British folklore in this regard. So in that, could you kind of go into what some of the folklore motifs that Casting the Runes and M.R. James have gone into, and give a few examples of some of the spooks that somebody might see in a campaign.
Okay, and also, if you don't mind, I'd love to go into some of the American parallels that people could use if they want to, you know, for American players who want to go that way with an American setting. Mm-hmm. Yeah,
that's perfectly well, fine.
For some of the more uniquely British ones, for instance, Arthur Machen, he is roughly contemporary to James, great Welsh horror and weird fiction writer. And he particularly specialized in this mystical, otherworldly type of horror, which was very heavy on the atmosphere of the Welsh mountains and so on. So there's a lot of paganism, a lot of, you know, or of mysterious pre-Christian influences of the natural and the wild forces in his work. So there are, fauns and satyrs and other sort of personifications of nature at its sort of wildest and most uncontrolled and fiercest. And Machen also went very heavily into weird mutation. And he went a bit into the sort of degenerate species breeding underground area that Robert E. Howard went into. So you've got these weird little people living under the Welsh hills who are like, it's very, very hard to pin down whether they were genuinely intended to be supernatural or merely some sort of, you know, subspecies of humanity, like those hobbits that developed on the Southeast Asian islands, who went underground and started a separate existence, but they became this weird, unnatural force beneath the Welsh mountains, who occasionally came out to kidnap people. So that's definitely one. William Hope Hodgson, who is the original writer of the Carnacki stories, the great occult detective. But he also goes into, again, these weird, somewhat, in some ways more Lovecraftian, sort of parallel universe type stories where you have swine people, sort of hog men, coming through dimensional rips into the English countryside and ravaging it. So that's another area of... very uniquely English writer, certainly. On the James front, he is very heavy on demons and ghosts, but he tends to portray his demons not as, you know, not as funny men in tight red suits with horns, but they are half seldom presences which are never fully described. But you mostly just get this horrific glimpse of one little bit of them, and then the rest is left to your imagination. So he's extremely good at reviving the great ancestral tradition of demonic horror in that way. I mean, the guy was the son of a Christian minister. Mm-hmm. He spent a long time studying. He was a student of the ancient history of the Bible. He became a very distinguished academic in that area. So he has got a very good grasp of traditional demonology, traditional occultism, which he deploys very lightly so that you get a good atmosphere of scholarship, but you don't actually have to know the stuff. But it does add a terrific pinch of flavor to it. So... you've really got all the atmospherics of, you know, having alchemical runes and ancient grimoires and witches flying through the air and so on. All of that is there. but touched in the most beautiful, suggestive detail without overkill. In the American setting, you know, like Edith Wharton, Poe, some of the works of any of the sort of great 19th, early 20th century tradition of American, you know, Henry James, The Turn of the Screw, mm-hmm. is a classic of the right kind of story for this kind of game. So American writers have also produced some really terrific work in this general area that would fit supremely well into the game. And, you know, the American setting would work fine for this, especially sort of a New England.
I would echo that. I think any American gamer that wants to really get a handle on James, you don't need to look much further than Edgar Allan Poe and Clark Ashton Smith. For me, Clark Ashton Smith has actually got more in common with M.R. James than he has H.P. Lovecraft. Even Robert Chambers, even though there's this now sort of merging together of the Cthulhu mythos and the Yellow King and Carcosa, really they're quite divergent. And there's more in common with this sort of this uncanny, unsettling side of things mm-hmm. in Chambers' work and Clark Ashton Smith's work than there is with Lovecraft. You don't really need to look much further than that to recreate that atmosphere. Casting the Runes will do it for you. You can do your Edgar Allan Poe style stories perfectly well with this system.
Yeah. And we just want people to be creative with them and, you know, not get stuck into a rut at all that's dictated by the system. So hopefully there's a good enough toolkit in there to allow people to do exactly that.
Now, in that regard, and this is something that came to mind while you were discussing those examples. Mm-hmm. I think a lot of people tend to conflate horror and weird fiction in where the mm-hmm. latter ends up getting absorbed into the former. So, do you think you could go yep. into kind of the difference in what defines horror and what defines weird fiction and where the dividing line is between the two?
I mean, Lawrence, please do feel free to cut me off on this at any point because it's a favorite hobby horse of mine.
You're gonna get so gone.
if you want to go, fine. But look, because I've been writing along both sides of the genre for ages now, and I do think the confusion a bit between them is a lot of issues because a lot of what traditionally is labeled as horror, you know, what actually happens in those supposed horror stories is not necessarily that scary. You know, it's bizarre, it's unsettling, it opens up windows onto other vistas of reality or other possibilities of the universe, but it doesn't necessarily physically or mentally threaten you per se. And yet a lot of that kind of writing traditionally has been bracketed as horror. I mean, for instance, classic example, Algernon Blackwood's The Willows, which is the story of two men marooned on an island on the Danube and these weird, irrational forces all around them. And are those forces threatening? They're never necessarily explicitly threatening or dangerous. They're definitely a window onto another level of reality. And it's exposure to the numinous, you know, this idea that there is something out there that is wholly beyond rational comprehension, wholly on a wholly different scale to the merely human, that is absolutely going to blow your mind, whether or not it actually explodes your skull. And that is definitely where horror and the weird come together. On the other hand, I think there's loads of horror that gets exactly that feeling across without being supernatural. You know, loads of psychological, I mean, The Wicker Man, or that recent great horror story, horror film, which is like Wicker Man, Midsommar, mm-hmm. those aren't supernatural. There's no ghosts in them. There's no suggestion that the pagan forces are actually real. And yet they are as horrific as any genuinely, you know, supernatural horror film. And So for me, the horror is actually that reaching of the safe and normal into something that's genuinely weird and scary, no matter where it's coming from. Whether it's the weirdness of the human mind or whether it is some uncatalogued weirdness in the out there in the universe on a supernatural basis. So, and I think weird fiction also suffers, funnily enough, from an unwillingness often to admit that it's horrible, you know, to admit that it's weird and threatening and to actually lose some of its most interesting resources as a genre, because a lot of weird fiction actually flattens out and tends to get rather dull and plain because it doesn't try to scare or upset or challenge. You know, just tries to provide a very vague whisper of the abnormal, and that's it. And so I think, you know, both sides suffer a bit from the genre argument. And if I'm trying to unsettle, I think there's loads of good ways to unsettle people. And then the end of the day, probably, it's best not to think too much about why, but rather about why or what. But more simply about how, you know, give them that right pacing, give them the right type and level of scares, and you will produce something that works. Mm-hmm. Now, that said, I also think that horror and to some extent weird stuff of all kind has suffered a lot from the sort of cheap slasher flick thing. And the gaming, you know, you can have a good slasher horror game, but that is not, that's often as silly and as open to parody as any of the worst Lovecraft imitators. Yeah, that's slasher flicks, they're not actually about scaring people. I mean, it's about adrenaline, yes, but the lack of imagination, the lack of anything for your mind to get its grips into, misses out the most genuinely frightening part of the entire equation. I mean, Lovecraft, you know, kicks off his classic critical studies saying the oldest emotion of mankind is fear, and the oldest fear is fear of the unknown. Mm-hmm. Now, that unknown can be supernatural or simply stuff that you haven't known yet. But it definitely is the most powerful force for creating fear. And obviously something like a slasher flick, you're not dealing with that. So if you want to frighten people, you got to go out for something more along what Lovecraft targeted. And that's where you can get something that really can scare, you know, get really can do the best that this area can do.
Yeah. And When it comes to the whole notion of the slasher, and this is something that I think was a very wise move, at least in regard to the preview that I've seen. While there is a section in the preview regarding creatures, what I do not see is the bestiary in the traditional sense. And while there probably is going to be a bestiary in the final book, there's a reason I say in the traditional sense. We do not have a kind of rogues gallery. We do not have a kind of monster of the week going on in this thing. Which I think the whole idea of the titular monster that ultimately ends up being the selling point of a film is mm-hmm. something I'd trace back to the days of Universal, where yep. the, and don't get me wrong, I love the works of Universal. I've been to the Nut House spelled with a K, even though that's Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. And as much as I like those works, it's what you have to acknowledge certain flaws that style has, that when trying to jump from them into this, there's going to be a degree of unlearning, I think.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
The reason why I focus on that is I get the feeling that while there may be some folklore creatures, would I be right in assuming that those are, that the creatures in the traditional sense are underplayed in this?
Yep. We've tried to include a sort of good representative selection and a recipe book and toolkit for building more, you know, so you can, but it's for a few reasons, partly because honestly, the folkloric sources are so rich and so various. You know, we'd rather people went out and found these ludicrous, bizarre, crazy, wonderful creatures from folklore and adapted them to the game with the relatively simple toolkit, rather than trying to get them all in at once. The other reason is one of the reasons that turned me onto Gumshoe rather than Call of Cthulhu, which is an argument that goes back right to Sandy Peterson in the 1980s and the original genesis of Call of Cthulhu. It's when Sandy Peterson didn't want to give the Elder Gods and the Great Old Ones stats. He didn't want to give them like 200, 300 hit points. He thought it completely took away from the genuine horror and mystery and unknowability of something like Yog-Sothoth if you made it just a big pile of hit points. Because if you make it just a big pile of hit points, people are just going to get hitty on it, and they're going to take the same old mechanical approach to getting rid of it, and that takes away the horror. Where is anything genuinely horrible and unknowable if you can just get rid of the thing by stacking up a big enough stack of dynamite? And so that is one. And like I say, Sandy Peterson, who is the presiding genius at the birth of Call of Cthulhu, he didn't want to do that. The publishers wanted it, so finally he went with it. But I think, honestly, it is... one of the main reasons that Trail of Cthulhu and Gumshoe kicked off and became such a big success is, as much as the strength of the Gumshoe system itself, it was simply they ditched the stats idea for the big bads. They said, look, these things are gods. These things are supernatural. These things are beyond your imagination, never mind beyond your puny weapons. So there is no sense giving you piles of numbers to deal with them. Mm-hmm. And that dictates a completely different attitude to, at the very least, to how you're going to deal with these things, if you can deal with them at all. And it definitely makes them a whole lot more scary. So that was one very strong reason for getting away from that kind of approach. Now, it's not to say that doesn't work wonderfully well for other types of games. I mean, there is a game out there called Monster of the Week, which is supposed to be fantastic if you want to play a Monster of the Week game.
Yeah, and I mentioned Chill a little bit ago, which is in that same kind of vein.
Mm-hmm, yep. And, you know, those are great games for what they want to do. It's just we wanted to try and find a game that was good for what we wanted to do. And hopefully we've done it. But I think both types, both approaches, really do have their good different strengths.
Now,
by the way, if you could spare a few minutes for a little bit of another rant on this subject as well.
go right ahead.
While we're on the subject of Monster of the Week, there is also this terrific intellectual snobbery in the weird fiction community, which is a massive pain in the ass. Because, and interestingly, I came across something like this when I was listening to one of the podcasts of one of the great presiding authorities on all things Lovecraft in the, you know, in the podcast community. And he said he wasn't familiar with Call of Cthulhu games. He wasn't familiar with gaming. Now, I don't think it's impertinent to ask, how can you understand where Lovecraft has come in the past couple of decades without knowing the massive influence that the games had?
I need to ask something. Is it a case where he snubs his nose at the concept of Lovecraft being adapted into games, or was he was it something else?
I don't think it was conscious snobbery or something. I think he just didn't, you know, he'd never really focused on that area. And yet I don't think it's possible to understand where Lovecraft is now and where weird horror is in the whole popular culture without knowing the massive influence that games have had. I mean, Lovecraft has benefited from that at least as much as fantasy has benefited from Dungeons and Dragons.
Absolutely correct. I mean, before Call of Cthulhu, the game, was released, Lovecraft was barely read. You know, some of his stories were included in anthologies here or there, but he was very much of an unknown author. I'd never heard of him before I heard about the Call of Cthulhu game. And the popularity of H.P. Lovecraft has increased incredibly as a result of the success of Call of Cthulhu as a role-playing system. So, yeah, I think Paul is absolutely spot on there. To not know about Call of Cthulhu and Cthulhu-inspired gaming, and yet have an interest in H.P. Lovecraft and his work, especially at this popular kind of level, is quite unbelievable, actually.
Well, we're kind of seeing something similar to that in the fantasy genre, with the fact that I am fairly certain that most people would not have known about the Witcher or Metro 2033 if it were not for the respective game adaptations.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
A lot of people would not have read Roadside Picnic if it were not for the cult success of Stalker.
Yep.
So.
Yep, completely agree. I mean, there's it's like Lara Croft and Angelina Jolie. You know, these areas do cross-fertilize, and whatever direction you're coming from, you miss a lot and you diminish your own position if you ignore or deliberately, you know, close your mind to those cross-fertilizations. Mm-hmm. One interesting point on this is that in the UK, probably M.R. James is better known than Lovecraft. Or at least he was better known than Lovecraft.
Yeah, he was
very short. Yeah, and so in the UK, it's almost the opposite story. You know, we're coming from an area that is much more associated with Lovecraftian game, and we are to some extent pitching to a larger horror fiction community that is completely unfamiliar with gaming, they only associate it with Lovecraft, and a lot of them don't know that much about Lovecraft at all.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so there's this it is very odd how ring-fenced these things get and cut off from each other when they are so important to each other.
And The only reason I asked if there was some kind of a snobbery is because I have seen that in some degree where some people will go out of their way to not acknowledge the fact that degree of cross-pollination even can exist.
Yeah.
a really good example of this, and I've had this debate with several people, I've always had to deal with that one person who will snub Warhammer or The Witcher because of its similarities to the works of Moorcock. And in some extreme examples, I've seen people who will outright accuse Andrzej Sapolsky of plagiarizing Moorcock's work for The Witcher, which, given the book, there's certainly an argument to be made, but it wasn't until I read a Medium post by the developer of Kingdom Come Deliverance, who talked about his experiences in the aftermath of the Iron Curtain, where it was hard to really get an understanding of game development in the West, quote unquote. And it was through that I started to understand why The Witcher became that level of the level of popularity that it would achieve in Europe and eventually in the world, because it is presenting a style of fantasy that is homegrown in Eastern Europe.
Yep, and very much.
When I learned about that, the whole notion of whether or not he plagiarized Moorcock is one of those cases of you can be technically right and still wrong at the same time.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
In other words, it's a case where if you want to be that level of anal retentive about it, it's true, but that statement is also disingenuous.
Yeah, and it definitely diminishes the speaker more than the target. I mean, go. Again, similar story with Sweden and the influence that Scandinavian, especially Sweden, has had on role-playing games. You know, cult and so on. It's obvious that you're getting a somewhat different and distinct tradition, which nevertheless can bring something really interesting to the table. Yep. And it's not coming from where, you know, it's not coming from the same roots. And even if it is adapting them, it definitely makes its own very, very different and distinct flavor.
Yeah. Part of the reason, as I mentioned earlier with you guys, I had McGrenery on a couple days ago, and he is translating The Elephant and Macaw Banner, and a major bit of appeal when it comes to that RPG as well, and subsequently the book series, is that it is distinctly Brazilian. It's taking place in 16th century Brazil. It's a lot of the motifs and a lot of the creatures and all that are from the folklore of that region. And that's part of what helped that series gain its foothold.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd imagine with casting the runes to bring this kind of thing full circle, even though there can be some adaptations with similar writers in the States, the impression that I get from the preview and what's been written on the Kickstarter page is that of a story that is distinctly British.
Yeah, or let's say distinctly European, and probably gets its, you know, you'll find similar approaches to this in French and German, but it really reaches its, like so many of the genres, even though you've got, you know, great French detective writers, etc., it really reaches its pinnacle with the English writers. And I think James absolutely represents the peak of that particular type. So, you know, we want to capture it, capture that at its height. Mm-hmm. And again, for other types of horror, for other types of weird, there's plenty of other examples and ways to capture them at their particular best. But we think, or at least this is an effort to capture that particular thing at its particular best and make it fun.
And if through this, more people end up delving into the works of M.R. James's writing. Oh, yeah. I think that can count as a win.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, for all kinds of reasons, I think that cosmic horror is uniquely suited to our uniquely cosmically horrible times. So it may not quite have the cultural impact of Lovecraft, but we will be happy with what it does as far as it goes.
Mm-hmm. And when it comes to something like cosmic horror, this is kind of the takeaway that I had gotten in that introductory thing is that it's akin to saying I enjoy myself a good s'more brat. I had one for lunch earlier today. Of course, for those listening who are not aware, s'more brat is an open face on rye sandwich. That's a bigger deal in Denmark. But yep. I don't want to have nothing but that.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
In one of my old reviews, I had said sometimes I want a nice, well laid out meal with a glass of wine that's made to accentuate it. And other times I just want a burger and a beer.
Mm-hmm.
You need that variety, and this is the reason that I think more interpretations of what you can do with horror role playing are going to be better in the long run because of the fact that you will have these opportunities to show more angles so that there isn't just the assumption that you have to do the Lovecraftian approach. You don't have to put a round peg in a square hole.
Yeah. Absolutely. It's one of probably just one of those functions of the way that the gaming industry operates that up till now, overwhelmingly, you've had, with Call of Cthulhu, basically 57 varieties of small broad. You know, it's like small, every kind of small broad in your gaming store that you could ever possibly wish for. And that's it.
Yeah.
And I think there is real room. You know, gaming is basically massively fun, massively diverse, and there's so many unexplored areas that are still waiting to be, you know, put into great games. And we'd love to see more of that rather than just monocropping in certain areas and certain styles.
And while there's always going to be some styles that are more popular than others, that's not a reason for these other styles to not exist. I mean,
absolutely not. And also, these days, the hobby has got a wider audience than it's ever had before. It's got more ways of playing games and getting together to play games than it's ever had. It's probably got a higher profile in the overall, in the culture and the popular culture and society than it's ever had. So that's all the more reason to, you know, spread things as widely as he can.
Mm-hmm. There's also the fact that there was always a kind of tells when it came to certain people getting into a hobby where you're always going to have that layer of the people who who follow the larger trends and the people who are entrenched in it.
Yep.
It's well to. Not to sound like too much of a sports nut, but it's like the people who would only watch the NHL because of Crosby, and the people who watch the NHL because they like where the league is going.
Mm-hmm.
Now I only use that as my main example because hockey is my main sport, even though I have to deal with the pain of being a fan of sports in Minnesota.
I'm gonna have to leave Lawrence to come out on this one.
the amount I know about hockey, you can write on a postage stamp. Actually, on half a postage stamp. But I do know who Sidney Crosby is. So.
Yeah. I'm not trying to gauge the knowledge and have some sort of phallus measuring contest regarding that. I'm just using that as a example. But there is no better time than this current age to look into what's out there, and there is something out there for every flavor, to the point where I've jokingly called myself a tailor when it comes to suggesting RPGs for people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it's really always been like that, to be truthful. I mean, even during the mid to late 80s and the early 90s, there were a plethora of role-playing games. You could cover so many different genres with games that were available. We had Aftermath Post-Apocalypse. We had Samurai role-playing with Bushido, Land of the Rising Sun, and so on. We've had traditional fantasy. We've had some very, very interesting takes on different genres. I mean, arguably, Vampire and the whole World of Darkness created its own kind of genre. I would hesitate to call it horror because I don't think it is, but it created the kind of genre that inspired Twilight and the Underworld films. So we've always had that kind of undercurrent. And now with the ability for people to be able to self-create and self-publish so easily, it's exploded out of all proportion. And I think where weird fiction and uncanny horror is, things like Bluebeard's Bride as a role-playing game, based very specifically. Mm-hmm. It's that kind of macabre. I mean, the whole myth of Bluebeard and very rooted in this whole European folklore genre. To base a game solely around that, and for it to be very, very effective in the way that it can convey the atmosphere and unsettle people, is testament to how far role-playing games have come. But it's always been there. I don't think this is something that's brand new. It's simply come more to the fore, A, because role-playing is finally accepted as not this geeky, basement-confined hobby anymore. It has come out of the shell, and it is now cool. That's very, very important. But I think the creativity in the hobby has always been there, and there's always been this big diversity to take it, whether you want to go the populist route of D&D, or if you want it to dig into some of the weirder little corners of things. There have always been games that kind of supported that style of play.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, to pick up on that, I do think that Bluebeard's Bride is a fantastic example. Just the production values are so high.
It's absolutely gorgeous, yeah.
Such an immaculate way. And yet, in some senses, it's plowing a very narrow furrow. I mean, it looks at a particular style of gameplay. You're going to have a particular length of, you know, it almost hits that crossover between traditional board gaming and role-playing games. And yet it's obvious that it's got an audience, and it's got an audience who laps this up and is, you know, ready to pay for the supplement after supplement and loves it. And it's, you know, it's great that something that is so tightly focused can be so well appreciated, so successful. you know, successful at what it does and successful commercially. And mm-hmm. that is a testament to how far the industry has come.
As a kind of further case in point when it comes to that cross-pollinization, mm-hmm. would you believe that English is my first language?
Don't worry.
I
believe any.
It's definitely mine, and I struggle with it every day, so don't worry.
And in my own review series, I'm currently, because of the fact that Chinese New Year has come and gone, I'm dedicating all of my reviews in the month of February to games that are in the wuxia subgenre of fantasy.
Oh, good. Mm-hmm.
And this was something that I first got into through the films. I mean, I had watched a lot of those really, really cornily dubbed martial arts films when I was a kid. And then when I discovered books like Shunrang Jurjun in Korea and the Storm Riders and Weapons of the Gods in Hong Kong, then I found out about the role-playing game equivalents, and through that I learned about the four pillars of wuxia fiction, and I expanded out from there. I went from one medium to the next. So trying to focus on just one interpretation of that medium is kind of doing the whole medium of storytelling, whether it be collaborative or single, a bit of a disservice.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and there are at least three or four really classically, really highly regarded games in this whole area, aren't there? I mean, isn't the next edition of Feng Shui just around the corner?
I haven't heard anything. They just did one, I think. There was Feng Shui 2 a few years ago. Mm-hmm. And for the record, Feng Shui 2 is something that I do have plans on covering, but it's not going to be this month.
There was a water margin game back in the early to mid 90s, and to me the epitome of wuxia is the water margin stories.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. That huge Chinese drama, that was fantastic. Mm-hmm. And also the monkey series that followed it.
Yes, yeah. Yeah.
Well, Journey to the West and The Water Margin are two books that are referred to as there are two books in what's referred to as the four pillars of wuxia fiction.
Mm-hmm.
The other two are Romance of the Three Kingdoms and Heaven's Sword and Dragon Saber.
It's amazing how close to Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon that is, isn't it?
I don't think that was wholly intentional, but it is one of those things you can't unsee, especially since Heavenly Sword and Dragon Saber and Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon have nothing in common.
No, but it's a fun coincidence. Mm-hmm. And actually, with the coronavirus thing going on, this is at a very, very good time to be focusing on this. You know, bringing things Chinese back into the spotlight.
Well, for me, it's a case of I'm doing as best as I can when it comes to highlighting these games that I find interesting, and especially since one of my all time favorite PC games of the 2000s, when BioWare was still at the top of their game, was Jade Empire.
Mm-hmm.
That is actually my personal favorite BioWare game. So through things like Exalted, even with all of that experience, I still consider myself a poor layman when it comes to wuxia fiction, but mm-hmm. I wanted to at least show what I could
just to show that this stuff is out there. You just have to go. You just have to grab it.
Yeah. No, it's there. It is great, and it is a. I honestly don't know whether it was really covered as much as it should have been, but it is nonetheless a testament to the gaming community that it has been covered as much as it has been with some really great games.
And of course, there's the one kind of cultural area that I'd like to see touched on in the future, and maybe this has, and I just haven't found it yet. Although that'd be quite a feat given how I'm always looking for things. Is kind of the folklore that would be seen in North America. I mean, the closest that I have in that regard is stuff like colonial Gothic, which is nice, but that's only one interpretation. And much like with the Cthulhu problem, we don't just want one flavor of Smorbrod.
Yeah, and that's one area where you do wonder if Call of Cthulhu has been a disservice to that. Because it's got enough going on of the colonial Gothic kind, and yet it's saturated that with its own mythos and crowded out the rest.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I agree. Mm-hmm. I agree that it would be lovely to see more of that foregrounded.
And I will admit, a good chunk of that is due to my own background with certain folklore heroes in the U.S. Of course, given that I'm in the Midwest, I'd be remiss if I didn't bring up Paul Bunyan, or things like John Henry. I at one point wanted to use an interpretation of the Jersey Devil into a story, and I've talked about the Wendigo, but there's those kinds of stories that I just see as a well that has yet to be tapped.
Yep, and it's also one of the most successful recent modern weird fiction, weird horror volumes is Nathan Ballingrud's North American Lake Monster. Which is, to some extent, very much about what it says it's about. You know, traditional, really, really rooted, really folkloric horror that's very much, you know, down into the traditions of these communities.
Mm-hmm.
And you can get some really strong stuff out of that. And again, anything but, much, much rather have anything than approaching that than the one size fits all, one flavor for everything approach. By the way, can I just briefly shout out the two areas I'd love to see covered that I don't think have been done well enough in gaming? One is Middle Eastern tradition, the Arabian Nights. You know, the whole, again, you've got a massive body of folklore, legend, myth, etc., including some legends, culture heroes that are known worldwide. And there hasn't been a feng shui or whatever style game that's really, so the Prince of Persia for role-playing would be fantastic. I think that,
I'm constantly astonished that nobody has tackled the Arabian Nights or that
million. I can think of a few games that have come close, but haven't gone all in. Stuff like the sister game to L5R, Legend of the Burning Sands, the recently released Capharnaum Tales of the Dragon Marked.
Yes, I know Sarah Newton has had a stab at that. I haven't looked at it to see if it's actually there yet. If it is, fantastic, because it certainly needed it for long enough. Mm-hmm. The other area, similarly, is Indian folklore. I mean, the gods, the traditions, the legends, it's, an incredible untapped area. And it would be wonderful to see that instaurated into a really good, really solid game or games.
The only games I can think of that have gone into that area, and there may be a few others, but I can't recall at the moment. One of them is Against the Dark Yogi, which is very much trying to do that mythic style of India.
Mm-hmm.
And the other one, which has been recommended to me, but I haven't delved deeply into it, is Arrows of Indra. And
okay, never heard of that one at all, but the title sounds...
I've definitely heard of Arrows of Indra. I haven't read it, but I do know about it. It is... we have our own mythics line, Mythic Britain, Mythic Constantinople, and so forth. And... a couple of upcoming books we've got. One is Mythic Polynesia, which has been seriously underdone.
I've only been able to find one game that tackles that, and I found that game years ago.
Yeah. Well, we have that on the cards. And something to do with Mythic India has been a project that we've been kicking around as an idea, as a project for Pete Nash to tackle. He's got a huge interest in the Mabharata and the folklore of India. So that may well happen from the design mechanism at some point. But it's definitely underdone.
Yeah.
Massively needs to be done. And but this is not to soap my publisher too much, but just to say that the upcoming Mythic Babylon from... Mm-hmm. Design mechanism is fantastic.
Wonderful.
That is an amazing piece of role-playing writing, and it absolutely lifts the lid on a totally gameable, totally believable, convincing, human, and yet utterly bizarre ancient culture. It basically does for it's the reality room quest. Finally, you've got genuine tradition that lives up.
I can hear coffee being spat through across computer screens all over the world.
Well, am I wrong? Come on.
You're not wrong. And two, given the stuff that goes on in my temple, you're in good company.
living in a world of Glorantham hand fasting, I don't think I need to say any more.
there's always something spicy that comes up anytime I open the doors to the temple, and I guess I can add that particular notch. But
with all due respect to Glorantham hand fasters everywhere.
If I end up getting half a dozen angry emails about how dare you, as somebody who besmirched our culture that way, I'm blaming you.
Okay, well, I'll just have to get all Babylon, obviously.
But in all seriousness, as a kind of defining note, and this is one of those traditions that I've established here. What would you say would be the defining statement as to what casting the runes is?
I would say it's really the absolute best of the great ghost tradition, the great ghost story tradition in a gameable form. That's it.
Yeah. This is the game that you want to break out at Christmas late at night to play in a smoky, darkened library with a roaring log fire going and scare the shit out of each other.
Yeah. the Christmas, it's the one that you want a Christmas ghost story. This is the one that you want to have under your tree.
Yep, which, I don't know, if somebody's going to have that under my tree, I'm debating whether or not I'll call an exorcist.
Yeah, just, make sure you got to light a cross on top of the tree or something. Bless the tree first.
Oh, of course.
And if you find any whistles in your Christmas crackers, don't blow them.
Exactly. Do not blow, yeah. That's the other, the quintessential message of this game is, if you find any funny-looking whistles on the beach, do not blow them, ever.
No, and to be honest, if I want to watch blowing, I'll just watch Toronto and I'll just watch the Maple Leafs in April. To the point where
it's a good job that I know next to nothing about hockey and can write it on half a postage stamp. Otherwise, I'd take great offense at that statement.
If it means anything, I trigger everybody's team. Even my own. One of the cardinal rules of the monastery is nobody is safe. If it exists, we will either riff on it, roast it, or find some way to laugh at it. No exceptions.
Good to know.
But I do want to sincerely thank you for taking the time and dealing with the bits of nagging on my part, as well as trying to finagle time zones to actually get this to work.
Yeah. No, hockey jokes notwithstanding, it's been great. Mm-hmm. Always happy to talk about gaming.
It's been highly entertaining, and thank you very much for having us, Mildred.
Mm-hmm.
Great to talk.
Yep. Okay. Now,
hope everybody enjoys the game.
Mm-hmm. I might actually break that out for Halloween week as a one shot in the temple, just to keep people on their toes. They already don't trust me enough as a DM because of my history of things. But keeping them paranoid is part of my job.
Yeah. Nobody can be as much of a Dennis Detweiler as Dennis Detweiler is, so you forget.
But with all that said, the main event podcast will return tomorrow, and that is going to be an absolutely stacked card because I've got to deal with the Unholy Quartet in its completeness. But until then, on behalf of the good brothers present and not present, my name is Mildra. I am your gaming monk. Stay fucking frosty, everybody.